Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. We carry on with part 2 for menstruating women and the fasting and also the payment of zakat. The exceptions in Al-Quran when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala exempts people from doing certain things are all around the Quran. But before delivering examples that will work for our case today, I want to say something very important that we believers must tattoo on our intellect, in our heart, and never ever forget that. Just like the tattoo on your hand is always apparent to you. This truth is, Allah never ever forgets. Pure and simple. He does not forget anything. Now, when I say this, you will think, as we humans do, that forgetting is always linked to the past. We don't forget what has happened, right? But what I also mean is that Allah not only doesn't forget what happened in the past, but He also did not forget what humanity will need in the future when He descended the Quran upon the Messenger. I mean, Allah hasn't forgotten what happened between Adam, his wife, the shaitan, and all what took place. Allah did not forget it. Allah did not forget what the people of Nuh did to every last one of them. Allah did not forget what the children of Israel endured and the arrogance of the Pharaoh and all that kind of stuff. Allah did not forget that. And on Judgment Day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remind us all, because on Judgment Day, everything that happened in this life becomes part of the past. Listen to how Allah puts it beautifully in the Quran. He says, يَوْمَ يَبْعَثُهُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا, the day that Allah shall send all humanity back to life again. That is the resurrection day. فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا, and on that day, Allah shall disclose to them, to humanity, all what they have done. أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ, Allah has kept a well-detailed and complete enumeration of each and every act specifically, while they had forgotten it. So Allah keeps track of everything. If I ask you a question, count 600 days from now. What were you doing exactly at 3 o'clock? You've got no clue, no idea. Neither myself. Nobody does. But Allah, if we asked Him this question, He would say, you were do, and you did, and you were when. Everything is precisely documented, awaiting Judgment Day. So, أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ, Allah has kept a well-detained and complete enumeration of each and every act specifically. And then Allah says, وَنَسُوهُ, and they had forgotten it, and we forget about it. وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ, and Allah is ever present and He is witness over everything that gets done. And this is in the Surah 58 and the ayah number 6. So this is for the past. As for the future, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to us today, when Allah revealed the Quran, that's the past. But when Allah revealed the Quran 1400 years ago, Allah took into consideration how humanity will turn. You see, Allah fully understands and knows how humanity is going to develop. So when He legislated and issued laws for humanity at the time of the Messenger, that is 1400 years ago, He did not forget to take into consideration their future. And as such, He legislated what humans will need to enter Jannah. And all this is done with the future in view, for better usage of word, rather than saying with the future in mind as we humans understand it. He took into consideration the abilities of humans in doing certain things. And He only asked us to do what we are capable of doing. And for that, He didn't impose on many types of humans to do certain acts they cannot do. If you can't pray standing, sit down. If you can't sit down, lie down. If you can't find water to make wudu, do tayammum, use dust, etc. So Allah took in consideration every possibility where a human will not be able to carry on the message or the command as Allah wants. The laws, all the instructions, the commands, the injunctions, the directives, everything that Allah issued in the past were done to respond to the needs of humanity. That's why the Qur'an is progressive, because it doesn't contain firm laws except in few parts, no more than 20. Other than that, the Qur'an progresses. It gives you theories. The Qur'an doesn't tell you 1 plus 1 equals 2. It teaches you how 1 plus 1 equals, and then you add and you use that as you progress in life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, each and every one of us, in whatever era we might be, how to follow the commands of Allah until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wraps up this world, terminates it, creates another world on earth, and prepares for judgment day. These laws are clear and understandable by all. And you don't need any scholars to explain to you that Allah took into consideration the future of humanity when He legislated the Qur'an. Number three, you and I calculate the future, our future, whatever we want to do, we always calculate it either knowingly or unknowingly. And we do that either to minimize the risks or increase our rate of success. For example, when you drive, have you noticed that you keep looking at signs and you look at the traffic? Do you know why you do that? Is you are planning for the future, how to minimize the risks of you having a collision or some kind of road hazard or road accident with somebody else, and how to stay safe. We are always in constant calculation for the future. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did exactly the same thing. Look at what the angels said in surah, in one of the surah of the Quran, in surah Maryam, that is the surah number 19. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was conversing with Jibreel, inquiring, asking, you see, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had a special relation with the angels, like all messengers did. They could interact, ask, and all that kind of stuff of the angel, like chit-chat, so to speak. Then Jibreel answers back and he says, وَمَا نَتَنَزَّلُ إِلَّا بِأَمْرِ رَبِّكِ. And we don't descend except when the command of your Lord is given to us. This is Jibreel telling Rasulullah, and this is also being told to us, that angels are always on a purpose. They are not just there for no reason. So they only come to earth, they descend from heaven down to us when commanded by Allah. And then Allah says, لَهُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِينَا. To Allah is whatever is between our hands, i.e. what we are on earth doing now. Sometimes I come to you and say, hey, what you got on your hand? And you go, why, what do you want? So you understand from me that I'm asking you what you got doing going on now, so that if you've got nothing, you can do something else. So the angels, they say, lahu, i.e. of that, we are always at the service of whatever Allah gives us to do on earth now. And also, وَمَا خَلْفَنَا, and whatever is behind us. And what the angels are doing is always serving one purpose: prepare humanity for judgment day. That's what it is. That's what they do. They work with the rain, the wind, the sun. They do all these kind of things. They take care of the world so that we can live. Build earth and increase in number, and whatever we do, they all are preparing us for judgment day. And then Allah adds, وَمَا بَيْنَ ذَلِكَ, and whatever is between what we are doing now and judgment day, i.e. the future, whatever jobs we're gonna do between now and our next task, is all by Allah's command. And here comes the kicker, وَمَا كَانَ رَبُّكَ نَسِيَّ, and your Lord is not the one who forgets. Therefore, my dear brothers and my sisters, whenever Allah issues a ruling which might comprise exceptions, Allah ensures in the Quran that humans do understand exactly what's expected of them, who is exempt from doing that thing, who is discharged of that ruling. Those Allah mentions in the Quran as exempt are, and I put R here in capital A-R-E. They are the exempt, and none, no one, even messengers, even angels, can add to that list. And whoever Allah says is not exempt, that they must do it, nobody can change that list. It's final. Let's take a couple examples to illustrate this point here. For example, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about going into war, you see Muslims, the believers, they were in Mecca, they struggled for years, and then they migrated to Al-Madina. Good and dandy. But the problem is, for 2 years, and Quraysh was preparing for the battle to attack Muslims in Al-Madina. Muslims were all scared for that period of time. And when Quraysh decided to start really becoming a nuisance, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the believers to get ready to defend themselves and go out and fight, defend themselves. But as he ordered the believers not to stay behind and to go do what it needs to be done to protect themselves, their loved ones, their concepts, their beliefs and everything, Allah excluded a category of people that are exempted from going to war. Allah says in Surah Al-Fath, that is Surah number 48 in the ayah 17, He says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٍ. There is not upon the blind any guilt or problems that he shouldn't go to war. And then he adds, وَلَا عَلَى الْأَعْرَجِ. And not upon the lame. Either they can't walk properly or they have a physical defect that prevents them from fighting. Then there is no blame in these people when they don't go to war. And when Allah says there is no blame, it means they don't go to war and they are exactly, totally accepted by the community. Nobody is allowed to frown or think bad of them. And then he says, وَلَا عَلَى الْمَرِيضِ حَرَجٍ. And not even on any sick person or ill person, any guilt or any problems for remaining behind. The Qur'an is clear, the exemption. But any who does not fulfill one of the three, then either if they are not blind or they don't have a physical defect or they are not sick, they must get out and go to fight. Even in social interaction exams, for example, yeah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this is incredible, Allah talks to us about where we can eat, from which houses we can eat. Allah issues a long list. Go to Surah number 24 and check it out when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الْأَعْمَى حَرَجٍ. I will read the English to speed up the time. Allah says, look at the details, yeah? There is no blame on the blind, any blame on the lame, nor any blame on the sick, nor on yourselves that you eat in your own houses, or your father's houses, or your mother's houses, or your brother's houses, or the houses of your sisters, or the houses of your father's brothers, houses of your mother's brothers, or in the houses of your mother's sisters, or in the houses of whose kids. And then the list goes on until Allah says, or in the houses whose kids you possess, or the houses of your friends. There is no blame if you eat together or separately. See, the Quran tells you can eat single or as a group. The Sunnah tells you if you eat alone, you are just like the shaitan. But the Sunnah is to eat together so that there is more barakah. The Quran says no, there is no blame whatsoever. You eat together or separate, there is no problem whatsoever. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and when you enter such houses, greet each other with a salutation appointed by Allah. A salutation that is blessed and good. Thus does Allah expound His signs to you in order that you will act with understanding. And this is in Surah number 24. You see the list for foods we eat. Now, I'll give you a third example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the length. How much Quran do we recite in our salat? You see, at the beginning of Islam, when the believers were starting and Islam was starting, people used to spend a long time in salat. The idea that the salat was given to Rasulullah in the night journey of the Mi'raj is a total myth. Because the salat started with Islam. It's not, subhanAllah, okay, for another day, okay. But for now, at the beginning, people would stand at night to pray. And that includes Rasulullah and those who were with him. But because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had commanded in the Quran that they should spend some time of the night and things like that. They were trying their very best to measure up how much of time they can be standing and praying. And because they could not really calculate the time exactly, Allah says this, and now listen to this. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ يَعْلَمُ أَنَّكَ تَقُومُ أَدْنَى مِنْ ثُلُثَيِ اللَّيْلِ. Your Lord knows that you stand. See, when the Qur'an was revealed to Muhammad, the messenger, Allah, that you, the pronoun, was directed to Rasulullah. But now that there is no messenger, that you becomes me. Unless Allah mentions the messenger by name or by title, anything Allah speaks about in a pronoun form, it talks about you and me. But anyhow, Allah says, your Lord knows that you stand in a salat, prayer at night, for nearly two-thirds of the night. وَنِصْفَهُ وَثُلُثَهُ. And at times, half of it, and at other times, you stand for one-third of it. وَطَائِفَةٌ مِنَ الَّذِينَ مَعَكَ. And so do a group of those who are with you. Allah in the Quran never calls the people who were with Rasulullah the companions or Sahaba. The appellation of As-Sahaba is purely political. Allah says those who were with you. And then Allah says, وَاللَّهُ يُقَدِّرُ اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارِ. And Allah alone precisely measures the night and the day. And this is valid for the entire earth. He says something now interesting. He says, عَلِمَ أَلَّن تُحْصُوهُ. Allah knew that you will never be able to precisely calculate it, the length of the night and the time. And then Allah says, فَتَابَ عَلَيْكُمْ. And for that weakness in you humans, Allah shown more mercy on you. فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنَ الْقُرْآنِ. So recite in Al-Quran whatever you can from the Quran. And this is why in the salats today, no matter how much you recite or how little you recite, it's all fine because of this ayah. This reduction came because of the exempts who could not read lengthy passages from Al-Quran. And here are the people that Allah has reduced this rule of reciting too much Quran because of them. He goes, عَلِمَ أَن سَيَكُونُ مِنْكُمْ مَرْضًا. Allah knew that some of you will be sick, and a sick person cannot recite a long Quran. آخرون يضربون في الأرض يبتغون من فضل الله. And some others will be traveling throughout the land seeking Allah's bounty, i.e. making livelihood. وآخرون يقاتلون في سبيل الله. And some others fighting in the purpose or the cause of Allah. And then Allah says, فَقْرَأُوا مَا تَيَسَّرَ مِنَهُ. So recite whatever you can from it. وأقيم الصلاة and perform الصلاة. And this is in surah number 73. These three examples highlight my point of view. Otherwise, the Quran is full of examples where Allah exempts groups upon groups from doing certain things, from the children of Israel when He prohibited them from drinking from a river, except, and to endless example, but to keep this talk under the 1 hour or 2 hours mark, I have to stop here, but you get the idea. Questions to ask. Anyone accept that Allah would go in such deep details to tell humanity which house we can enter and eat from, and that He would completely ignore menstruating women when He exempted the sick and the traveler from fasting? Would anyone accept that Allah would go in details to tell humanity who can be exempted from going to war, and that He would completely ignore women when it comes to fasting? Again, would anyone accept that Allah would go in such details to tell us how much of the Quran we can recite in our salat, and why this exemption came about, and then would completely ignore women, to exclude women from menstruation when they fast Ramadan? My dear sisters and my brothers, exemptions in Al-Quran are all over, and for various acts of worship. Some are compulsory, some are not. For Hajj, it's got exemptions. For Zakat, it's got exemption. For Salat, it's got all kinds of worships in Al-Islam, in the Quran mentioned, do have exemptions. But then again, I will cover this, inshallah, in a more detailed talk. But for today, as I said, I'll keep this short. Let's think before we proceed with the topic at hand. On Judgment Day, my dear sisters and my brothers, when all humanity shall rise again, each people will come together as one to stand the first trial between them and the messenger that Allah sent to them. Then once that testimony is fulfilled, then we scattered and then we will all meet Allah individually. The interesting part is that each and every prophet or messenger shall bring the book of law that Allah revealed to his people. And here is the kicker. It is against that book those people shall be held accountable. As for us the believers, we will come, all of us will come as one people on one side, and the Prophet Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, the envoy of Allah, facing us, and as the witness for or against us. But the Qur'an tells us that the messenger will stand on one end and the whole Muslim nation on the other one, the believers, and the messenger will point at us and he will say, "My Lord, my people have forsaken the Qur'an." And this is exactly what we are doing today. The messenger will witness against us. My job and your job is not to be with those people that the messenger will point to and he will tell you, "Allah, that my people have forsaken the Qur'an." For example, the children of Israel at one point were commanded by Allah to kill themselves as an act of forgiveness. So if they want to be forgiven, the person has to kill himself. So if they kill themselves, then they get reward. Is that true today in our religion? It is not. That was in the Torah and that was the law back then. So on Judgment Day, the people that kill themselves will be rewarded. So you see how this functions? It's according to the book that was revealed to these people and not according to Sunnah, whatever it says. My dear sisters and my brothers, on Judgment Day, the Jews on Judgment Day shall have the Torah as the reference point for their deeds. In other words, their actions are judged against the Torah. The Christians, on the other hand, shall have the Injil or the Gospel as the reference point for their deeds, and their actions shall be judged against the Injil. We the believers, on the other hand, we shall have the Qur'an as the reference point for our deeds. In other words, our actions are judged against the Qur'an and nothing else. There will be no Bukhari, there will be no Muslim, no Tirmidhi, no Abu Dawood, no Malik, no Hanafi, or no Shafi'i, no Ahmed ibn Hanbal. There will be no Ibn Taymiyyah, no Al-Albani, no Ibn Baz, no Ibn Uthaymeen, no Al-Fawzan, no Sudais. There will be no Righteous Predecessors. There will be absolutely nobody else except the Qur'an. Listen up to what Allah says, and you can listen to it today, or bite your fingers on Judgment Day. Choice is yours. Because what I'm going to tell you is the ultimate truth. And it should reside in everyone that is serious about their Judgment Day. I'm not going to tell you what I or scholars say. I'm going to tell you what Allah will tell you. He says, وَيَوْمَ نَبْعَثُ فِي كُلِّ أُمَّةٍ شَهِيدًا عَلَيْهِمْ. And the day we shall rise up from every nation a witness against them. Min anfusihim, from amongst themselves. I.e. that person will be from us. وَجِئْنَا بِكَ شَهِيدًا عَلَى هَؤُلَاء. And then we shall bring you, and Allah is speaking to Muhammad here, he tells him, we shall bring you forth as a witness against these. And he means us, the believers. The Jews, they will have Moses and all the messengers and prophets that came, and the Christians will have Jesus and so on and so forth. Then Allah adds a very important point. That point being the criterion against which the believers shall be accountable, shall be held accountable to. Allah says in the same ayah, وَنَزَّلْنَا عَلَيْكَ الْكِتَابِ. And we sent down upon you the book of law, the Qur'an. تِبْيَانًا لِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ. As a clarification for all things. I.e., the Qur'an has got everything that we need to enter Jannah. Wahudan, and a guidance, the Qur'an is also a guidance. Warahmatan, and a mercy. Wabushra lil Muslimin, and a very good news for the Muslims. For your information, we today call ourselves wrongly. We call ourselves the Muslims. We are part of the Muslims. We are not the Muslims. We are the believers, and that's why in the Quran, Allah always, when He wants to issue a ruling, He always says, "Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu," those who have believed. Because the Jews are Muslims. The Christians are Muslims. We are Muslims. It's just we believe in Muhammad, they believe in Jesus, and they believe in Moses. The Quran is a total clarification of all things that humans need to gain the pleasure of Allah and enter Jannah. It's a book of guidance, it's a book of mercy, and it's a book of good news. Watch, Allah never ever associates something with the Quran, just like He never ever associates anything with Himself. Pay attention. If this truth sinks into your heart, that what is demanded of you as a believer is to follow the Quran only, wallahi, you will lead really a life of mercy, a life of guidance, and a life of good news. Look at you. All the decades of Islam and prayers and things, and you're still not sure you're going to make it to Jannah. You're still scared to death because we are away from Al-Quran. Al-Quran, my dear sisters and my brothers, is a book that contains all things and in a very clear and distinct way. And that will lead us will lead mankind as a whole towards Allah. The clarification of all things that shall lead to the mercy of Allah. And not only that, but the Quran, Allahu Akbar, has within it a huge news for us. What else do we wish from Allah? To believe in the Quran. It looks like we're talking to Quraysh. Well, sometimes I feel like I'm talking to Quraysh, not to people who says La ilaha illa Muhammad Rasulullah, and every time they say we follow the Quran, then they associate with the Quran the Sunnah. It should be follow the Quran alone, just like the companions did. Today the Muslims, they spend more time in the Messenger of Allah said, "Oh, it is Sunnah to do this. Is it Sunnah to do this?" Much, much less is it spending time on Allah, on the one who sent the messenger. Subhanallah, sometimes when I call people to Quran, they make me feel as if I was calling them to atheism, like don't believe in God altogether. This is strange. But anyhow, this brief introduction is very necessary to what's coming up next. You see, when the scholars of the past designed Al-Islam, those scholars designed an Islam that we follow today, they omitted, they completely neglected one major player, the Quran. And whenever these people faced a text, whatever they faced, and they could not resort to that, they used some tricky techniques to bypass Al-Quran, and they have succeeded until our times. You see, in the past, the level of intelligence in humans were not developed. People were not all literate. The majority of people didn't read and write. So the scholars were the eyes and the mouth of people. People couldn't read the Quran except what they heard. And just like when you go to the church today, the priest only mentions passages from the Bible, those passages that work with the church. And they hide the majority of the Bible. Well, our scholars did exactly that before then. People couldn't read. Books were just read by scholars, and that's that. And people took whatever those scholars said at face value. Yes, it must be the truth. But today, alhamdulillah, we are smart. We have got PhDs, we've got intelligent people, we've got people of all kinds, and reading is a given fact these days. And that's why today we actually found out that what those righteous predecessors did was a huge calamity. What these people have designed has led us against the wall for 1400 years. And this is why this brief introduction is much, much needed. Again, when these people have designed the Islam, they omitted Al-Quran. Those righteous predecessors could not figure an issue, instead of trying harder, instead of studying the Quran deeply, instead of thinking out of the box, they resorted to external arguments. And slowly, 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 those external arguments, the Hadith and the Sunnah, became Islam. And as for those parts where the Qur'an or what they couldn't reconcile or understand, they resorted to a very deadly trick. And they made the Qur'an the laughing stock of all other scriptures. Look at this. Every time the Muslims don't understand something, they resort to, oh, you know what? This ayah is abrogated. As if Jibreel came down with the Qur'an and another book of the, this ayah is no longer valid, this ayah is replaced by this, that is no longer valid, don't do this, don't do that. Actually, this is a lie. There is only one book that was descended by Allah. That book did not change, will not change, until Allah inherits the earth, and that is what is in it and upon it. So every time those righteous predecessors did something, we ended up in deep, hot trouble. The idea of the righteous predecessors is nothing else but a protective wall. You see, they made this embargo around them so that righteous predecessors, let's say, they don't make mistakes, these righteous predecessors. They don't fart, they do nothing. They are total angels. Even when they tell us stories, Abu Bakr, you only know the good things, Abu Bakr. And they completely hide away all the vile things that he did. Umar is much loved and they call him Al-Faruq. To a lot of companions, Umar was a tyrant, was a dictator. Many companions hated Umar the way he ruled. They completely abhorred what he did. Many people also were against Uthman. But history hides a lot. So much so that Umar, subhanAllah, there is no much difference between Umar and a dictator. What the king of Saudi Arabia or the crown prince does is fully justified by Umar. That's it. But that is politics for you. But what these righteous predecessors said is the term righteous predecessors is a protective wall against the errors of the people of the past. Take any Salafi, the first thing that you can rest assured of, every Salafi is totally ignorant of history. They got no clue what has happened before. And the moment you try to explain to them, they say, oh, these are people that have lived at one point. تلك أمة قد خلت. That's a people that have perished. لهم ما كسبت وعليها ما اكتسبت. To them the good and upon them the evil. And we are not going to be asked about them. So none of our business. Well, I'll tell you something. It is our business. And the righteous predecessors, this concept has nothing to do with the Islam that Allah wants. So the concept of no matter how clever humanity gets, the righteous predecessors knew better because they were closer to Rasulullah. The understanding of the righteous predecessors is the understanding. This is nothing else but a button that you push that says freeze your mind, don't use it. And that's an option Salafis love a lot. It turns us into zombies. Look at Salafis. Total living zombies. And let me tell you what a zombie, what the dictionary says about being a zombie. A zombie, they say, you can describe someone as a zombie if their face or behavior shows no feeling, no understanding, or any interest in what is going on around them. In horror stories and some religions, a zombie is a dead person who has been brought back to life. That's why you are given the impression that to be the true Muslim, to be the best Muslim, to be the real Muslim, you must physically live in the 21st century, but mentally and behaviorally live in the first century. Of course, and you dress like 1,400 years ago, your beard looks like that, and all that kind of stuff. Of course, Muslims who adopt this kind of zombiness have no clue whatsoever that the Islam of the righteous predecessors they follow today has got nothing to do with what Rasulullah ﷺ did, but rather what the people who came 250 years after the death of the messenger imagined what life was at the time of Rasulullah, and they documented al-Islam, as I said again, based on agendas, cultures, and all kinds of stuff. That's why, my dear brothers and my sisters, we must break away from this mess of the righteous predecessors did or said. And we must start following the righteous current. And the righteous current is what the Qur'an says. And to do that, we must increase our trust in Al-Qur'an. When Allah says something in Al-Qur'an, He speaks the truth. He's not kidding us. He's not just saying it for just saying it like that. Actually, when Allah says do that, He means it, and He means it 1000%. Ramadan and women. When Allah prescribed the fasting in Ramadan, He made it for men and women. When you look into our books of tafsir and fiqh and all these things about Ramadan, you get confused. They will tell you that Ramadan was prescribed in year 2, along with zakat and jihad and all this stuff. And that's why the expedition of Badr took place in Ramadan, in the first second year of migration. And then they have other problems. The ayat that deal with the Quran, in the Quran, deals with Ramadan at different levels. When they could not explain those different levels, they say, year one it was like this, it was not compulsory, it was like voluntarily, you want to fast, you don't want to fast, you don't want to fast. And year two, Allah made it compulsory. And this is a huge lie, because our righteous predecessors didn't know how to deal with these two parts of the Quran. So they made one valid and the other one bye-bye, just for historical entertainment. Okay? But you see, when Allah prescribed Ramadan, the fasting of Ramadan, Allah was fully aware that fasting, the act of fasting, is actually a tax on the human body. And He knew that that tax will affect the physique, the energy, and all that kind of stuff, and also the way we think and act and all that kind of stuff. And He also was fully aware that not all humans can tolerate this fasting. Thus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being the merciful that He is, as He promised in Al-Quran in plethora of places that the Quran, Al-Islam, is easy, and Allah has made it easy for us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala lifted this tax from few types. And He did this in the Quran. Don't believe the hype and the lies that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also did it. And I will get to this point later. What Allah wants from you, from me, from us, from the guy who's going to live thousands of years after now, is what's in Al-Quran. You see, Allah made it this way for some people. He gave them the opportunity to make up their fast. Ramadan comes in, and if you are sick or you are a traveler and you cannot fast now, then no problem. Fast later, make it up later on. Say someone was sick for 5 days or traveling for 5 days, Ramadan finishes. Hey, this person is completely free. They've got 11 months to choose when. They can choose to do them in the shortest days of winter, and guess what? They will get full reward. And they can do it in the longest days of summer, and they get the reward. It's left entirely up to you. So this is the people who make up. For others who cannot tolerate this tax of fasting, either they are continuously traveling or continuously sick, then these people will feed for every day a poor person. No big problem. Alhamdulillah, you ransom yourself, and that's that. But there is a third category that the scholars hide. And they hide it with a vile purpose. And that they say, always they say this, if we told people, people will become lazy, as if Allah has given the responsibility to these scholars to actually run al-Islam, and they are kind of like they become misers, they become stingy on who gets to Jannah and who doesn't get to Jannah. They say, well, if we told this to people, people will become lazy and that they will not worship Allah as He ought to be. Who gave you this authority? If Allah has made it simple and easy, who are you to stop the mercy of Allah? That's why Allah in the Quran says that if the mercy of Allah was given to you, nobody would ever see any goodness out of it. But there is a third category. The third category is a person who can fast, they are not sick, and they are not traveling. normally they should fast, but actually cannot fast. For example, let's take Egypt. Egypt, it's an old country, poor, tyrants have got everything. Ramadan comes in summer. People start fasting from 4 o'clock in the morning until 9 p.m. It's a long, long, long day. But some people, they work in offices and they have ACs and life is good for them. But let's say there is Muhammad or Ali, whatever number of this person is. And this guy is a taxi driver. In his car, there is no AC. And he works locally in Cairo. He goes from A to B, picking up people, driving under the sun to make a livelihood, had a livelihood. This person is not traveling and is not sick. And by the Qur'an, this person must fast. But being in a car under the sun, in that heat, scorching heat, makes it difficult for this person to fast. Guess what? Allah gives a concession to this man. He tells him, that is, you are supposed to be fasting, but your condition does not allow you to fast. No problem. Islam is easy. Feed one single person and don't fast. Isn't that beautiful? Isn't that absolutely beautiful? Now, do you need a scholar to tell you when to do this? You actually don't need. All you have to do is do this. Am I sick? No, I am not. Am I traveling? No, am I not. Is fasting my condition? For example, someone works in a bakery and is cooking, chef and things like that, hot, gets thirsty and things like that. Can I fast? I can. Is it too difficult? Yes. Then I will feed a poor person. And nothing? No bad feeling at all. Of course, Allah says, وَإِن تَصُومُوا خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. And if you were to fast, that would be better for you. So this is Allah's suggestion. He says, in my point of view, if you fast, it's better for you. But if you don't fast, feed one person, no grudge against you. So how about women? The menstruating women, did Allah mention anything about them in fasting? Why doesn't a woman pray when she has her menses? Why doesn't she fast? Where does this thing come from? If it's not in the Quran, where does it come from? Before going any further, let me explain a little bit what menstruation is. Well, to you ladies, you know, whatever, but believe it or not, a lot of guys don't know. They just know it's blood comes out of a woman and that's that. But in my years of dealing with the community, giving talks, all that kind of stuff, I have come across where people actually don't know what menstruation is. So let me say it in my own simple way, so to speak. Menstruation, it can sound amazingly beautiful, especially for a young girl who is expecting, is wanting to become a young woman. It's the sign that that little kid is actually being welcomed in the world of womanhood. To a lady, to a female, you are born with hundreds of thousands of eggs. You come already with all the eggs that you are going to need in this life. After puberty, a gland in your brain sends a monthly message to your ovaries and it tells the body, hey there, release an egg. This is the time of that month to release an egg. Of course, there are factors like anxiety, stress, and all that kind of the eating habits and things like that that play because they affect the way the brain functions and the message gets delayed or early depending on the circumstances. But if all is functioning properly, it should be every 4 weeks, give and take a few days, where that message gets sent, release an egg, and the body obliges, and that's it. The process, the whole process of a woman menstruating can take around 450 to 550 times in a lifetime. That is between 36 to 47 years, provided you live 60, 70 years, that kind of stuff. Okay, so it's a long, long process. So many hundred months that you're going to be going through this cycle. But from the inside, how it affects the woman, actually, it doesn't feel good at all. It's not as awesome as it might seem. Because every month, when that message gets sent, release an egg, a woman can feel totally a totally different person, either physically or emotionally. And that is in not a good way. emotionally, it affects a lot, because always remember that's the time when a woman is ready to perceive. And then physically it drains the woman, and the blood is unneeded blood. You see, when Allah forbade drinking or eating of blood with our mouths, it's haram because it harms us. Also, the blood that comes out from a woman is a harm to us, exactly as the blood that comes from your mouth when you brush your teeth is harmful to you. That blood, it is haram to swallow your own blood. Even if it comes from your teeth, you must spit it out. Okay? So, blood in any way. And let me give you a small thing that even the Arabs themselves don't know. The blood in Arabic is called ad-dam. Ad-dam. And the reason it's called ad-dam is from ad-dawam, ad-daymuma. It's the continuation, is continuing to live. Because it is a symbol of continuation of life. That's why when the blood comes out, life is threatened. That's why you've got the red signs and all that kind of stop is always in red. Meaning if you don't oblige to the stop sign, your blood is going to drain. It's going to run out and you're going to die. So that's on a side dish. But anyhow, so if a woman is smart and knows how to interact with this, well, menstruation will not derail her life. She will know how to cope with things. And alhamdulillah, she can do a lot of things that she would do in normal days. Except the part where the blood comes from. It becomes a hazard area. Just like if I brushed my teeth and the blood comes out of my teeth, then my teeth, my mouth becomes a hazard area. If the woman has menstruation blood coming out of her vagina, then that part of her becomes a hazard area. If I hurt myself and I cut myself open in my finger, the finger becomes a hazard area. It's the blood that is the problem, not where it comes from. It's the blood. If someone's the nose is bloody, then it's the where it comes from. And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prohibits man to sleep sexually with the women, because it's just, let's say, I don't know, if your wife or your husband has got blood in their mouth, it's haram for you to kiss them because you're going to swallow their blood. So it's not where it comes from, it's not the sexual aspect of it, it's the blood. That's where the problem is. But anyhow, so this is like a small education that when you see, in our culture as Muslims, you have this disease that is deeply rooted in us, in the male at least, the community, and also in female, it's been hammered. That is when a woman is in her menstruation or the period cycle, that is the time when the woman is actually a half human, half intelligent, and half religious. And this is absolutely a lie. The messenger would never utter such a huge lie. Anyhow, so now let me deal with the fasting exemptions. Who were exempted by Allah in Ramadan? It's these two questions have been answered by Allah Himself. And how do you know that? It's Allah's spokesperson, for lack of better words, the Qur'an, that has conveyed to us, clarified to us, explained to us, showed to us, pointed to us, and guided us, the believers, who shouldn't fast. Listen up to what Allah says. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu. To you who believed. So the speech is to us, the believers in Muhammad, the believers in the Qur'an. It's not to the Jews, it's not to the Christians, it's to us, the believers. Kutiba alaykum as-siyamu kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. Fasting has been written upon you as it has been written upon those before you, so that you reach piety. It's not to feel hunger, it's not for any other reason except to reach piety, to be God-fearing, God-mindful, far more than we ever did before. And then Allah tells us, أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودَاتٍ, for few number days. And then He says, فَمَنْ كَانَ مِنْكُمْ مَرِيضًا, whoever of you is sick, أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ, or is on a journey, on a trip, فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ. He or she should make up an equal number of days from other days throughout the year. وَعَلَى الَّذِينَ يُطِيقُونَهُ. And as for those who are capable of fasting, i.e. they are physically and mentally sane and sound and everything, they are not traveling and they are not sick, but cannot fast it, as I gave the example of the man who's driving and all that kind of stuff, then there is a fidya. The fidya is a ransom. What this means is, normally if you don't fast, you're going to get to hellfire. Now, can you ransom yourself with somebody else? Yeah. Oh, I give you this person, put them in hellfire and I don't go. What Allah says, if you ransom your day with someone else, then that act of ransoming is you saving yourself from hell fire. And then what is that ransom, Ya Allah? He gets the feeding of a poor person. Not clothing, not donation, not a holiday trip, not on cruise on the Bahamas. It's feeding. And the feeding here is subjective. In England it's £5, in Pakistan it's £1, in Italy it's £9, and so on. You get the idea. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَمَنْ تَطَوَّعَ خَيْرًا فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَّهُ. Then whoever pushes himself to fast, that is better for them. In the English translation they say whoever volunteers. It's not an act of being a volunteer. طَوَّعَ, that means you force yourself. Like that taxi driver, Allah tells him your conditions are hard and you don't want to fast, no big deal. Just feed someone as a ransom and that's okay. But Allah tells him, but if you push yourself and you fast, that's better. You will get better result out from that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also remember, my dear brothers and sisters, when Allah talks to the believers, He talks to men and women equally, 50-50%. And then Allah says, wa anta sumu, and if you were to fast, is better for you. If you only knew, and of course we should trust Allah, He knows. Then Allah introduces to us this new proposal, a new scheme altogether that is to help us to get better, and that is for our sake, and our sake with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear sisters and my brothers, the fasting days hold a very special in the sphere of laws. Ramadan, when you fast, they really hold a very special place in the sphere, because Allah sent down upon humanity His book in Ramadan. Look at it this way. Salat doesn't have a name. It just has a description of it. Hajj doesn't have a name, just a description of it. Zakat doesn't have a name, just a description of it. Fasting, it has a name, and the name is Ramadan. Have you ever asked yourself why Ramadan possesses a name? Well, I will tell you why. Because Ramadan cannot, the month of fasting cannot stay unknown, unnamed. Because Al-Quran is named and is such a prestigious book, it cannot happen just in an unnamed month. The Quran deserves far better than that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave a name to the month in which the Quran was revealed. Both elements are well known, because when somebody has a name, they are well known. Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was revealed, and you can also say the Quran was revealed in Ramadan. But you cannot say the Quran was sent in a month of fast, and the month of fast is where Ramadan was sent. You see, the Quran was sent down. It doesn't sound good. But anyhow, this is why the introduction was simple, beautiful, nice, and everything. شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. Ramadan is the month in which the Quran was sent down. This Quran is what? هدى للناس, a guidance to mankind. وَبَيِّنَاتٍ مِنَ الْهُدَى, and is also, the Quran is a clear proof of guidance and the standard with which we rule. And that's why Allah calls him Al-Furqan, because it distinguishes between right and wrong. No hadith, no sunnah, no sayings of the scholar. The Quran can do that job. Then Allah says, فَمَنْ شَهِدَ مِنْكُمُ الشَّهْرِ فَلْيَصُمَهُ. So whoever of you witnesses the month physically and mentally without the exception, the hard difficulties, as I said, the taxi driver and so on, then Allah says you fasted. If you have no reason as to why you shouldn't fast, then you must fast. وَمَنْ And another time Allah comes back again, وَمَنْ كَانَ مَرِيضًا أَوْ عَلَى سَفَرٍ فَعِدَّةٌ مِنْ أَيَّامٍ أُخَرٍ, to emphasize that only these two people cannot fast, those who were sick or who are sick or are traveling, then they should make up their fast on other days. Mention, Allah did not mention pregnant women, didn't mention the menstruating women, He just says sick or traveling. And then Allah says, يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ بِكُمُ الْيُسْرِ, Allah certainly wants ease for you, وَلَا يُرِيدُ بِكُمُ الْعُسْرِ, and He does not wish to make things hard or strenuous, laborious or difficult for you. Allah could have said, and Allah wants to make things easy for you, but because sometimes you make easy for somebody, but the thing is not easy. Allah wants to make things easy, and He makes them not difficult. It's two times easy, subhanAllah. And then Allah says, وَلِتُكْمِلُ الْعِدَّةِ, and you complete the number of days, that is the month, you fast. وَلِتُكَبِّرُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ, and then at the end of Ramadan, you grandify Allah for your guidance. And that's why on Eid day, we say Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and we say Allahu Akbar, it's because it's in the Qur'an. It's interesting, people think Eid is Sunnah. Eid, everything that Rasulullah ﷺ did authentically is actually from the Qur'an. That's it. This is for who? For anyone who can and cannot fast. And really, the top of simplicity and easiness. But the humans vow to complicate this matter of fast beyond recognition. Look at it this way. In another ayah, in 187, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us about how we fast and the duration. Simple, easy, shmeezy. And it's unbelievable. Allah legislated Ramadan in four ayat. Ayah 183 from Surah Al-Baqarah, the Surah number 2, 184, 185, and 187. The 186 is just between, if we ask what is Allah, Allah says, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةً, and if they ask you what is Allah, say Allah is close, you just make dua to Him. But the Ramadan, the whole fasting issue was dealt with in four ayat. That's it. It talks to us and make it simple and all that. Only four ayat for Ramadan. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closes this whole subject with, as I said, what we can do at night sexually and from when to when we fast. But when you look in the books of hadith and fiqh and things like that, it's books upon books upon books of fiqh until they complicated the issue beyond recognition. You can't, la ilaha illallah. Now, listen up to what Allah says in the Quran about how we fast. Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا, and eat and drink at night, of course. And then He says, حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ, i.e. you eat and drink at night until the white thread of light of dawn appears to you, distinct from the black thread, i.e. the darkness of night. I personally, Abdus Salam myself, I never ever respect the times of stopping to eat in the morning. These days, in this Ramadan this year, they say you stop eating the suhoor at 3 o'clock in the morning. I don't. I keep eating until I start seeing dawn, the light, the thread of light coming out. Allah says, until you see حتى يتبين, i.e. with your own eyes you see it. People stop at 3 and I'm still, 3:15, I'm still eating. No problem at all. Because Allah says, you keep eating, وَكُلُوا وَشْرَبُوا, eat and drink until with your own eyes you see, you can distinguish between the day and night. That's when you stop. Not look at the watch. And alhamdulillah, I gain sometimes 20 minutes. People have stopped and I'm still eating. And that's the beauty of the Quran. Again, I always will tell you this. Do not follow the calendar on your refrigerator. Follow your window. Then Allah says, ثُمَّ أَتِمُّ الصِّيَامَ إِلَى اللَّيْلِ. Then complete your sawm, the fasting, until nightfall. We do it until Maghrib, but that is because the scholars said Maghrib is the beginning of the night, when in fact, at the time of Rasulullah ﷺ, it was until it got dark, not to Maghrib. But again, that's what our righteous predecessors said, and they carried the sin till Judgment Day. Because to Allah, sunset is Ghurub al-Shams, is when the sun has set. But anyhow, that's a story for another topic. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, I'm coming up to the hour here. I'm going to stop here and then go to part 3, inshallah. And again, this is your brother, Abdus Salam, and I'll see you on next talk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.